Hey guys, today we'll be rebuilding the old HP 1287C. We'll be replacing the original motherboard with a new AsRock Z77 Extreme4. I'll publish another detailed installation video separately because I want to keep this one moving along. We'll also be installing a Kraken X41 CPU water cooler, and we'll be putting it all in an NZXT S340 case. The i7 used to run really hot in the old case, so the water cooler isn't as much for overclocking as it is to keep the CPU cool, so it'll do more work and last longer. I picked the older Z77 motherboard because I wanted to reuse that strong i7 that was in the HP. The Extreme 4 is bargain price these days, and it has everything that we'll need. It can handle up to 32GB of DDR3 RAM, and has an 1155 socket, and it's a perfect fit for the third generation Malaysian CPU. The board has two X16 PCIe slots, two legacy PCI slots, and it also has four Sata 3 ports that'll allow us to use a pair of SSDs, and also a pair of SSHDs so we can improve I/O. And while it's not really critical for this build, the Extreme 4 is a gorgeous motherboard. Look at this thing. Let's get it into the case. First we'll snap in the rear I/O panel, then we'll just drop the motherboard in place. During installation, hold it up at an angle and press it gently against the rear of the case, then just lower it onto the standoffs. The S340 case has that helpful center pin standoff that makes it easy to align the motherboard correctly the first time. So here's the Malaysian i7. It still has a thermal paste left over from the previous install and an Intel motherboard that went in post. I'm not sure if you've seen that or not, but I had to send that board back. When you're installing the CPU, make sure that you align the triangle on the CPU with the triangle on the CPU retention clip. The socket is designed to make it easy to install the CPU, just don't twist it or move the CPU from side to side. When you're locking down the retention clip, push it away from the hold down screw, push it down till it touches the motherboard, and the ears of the retention clip will naturally slide under the head of the screw. The CPU cooler also has the thermal paste from the failed Intel motherboard episode. No worries, it cleans up easy with alcohol. Okay, so my take on thermal paste is this. It's best to spread it out evenly over the CPU so you get complete coverage. I know that there are a lot of other thoughts on this, but NZXT packages their cooling block with the thermal paste already applied, and they spread it out evenly. You have to figure they know what they're doing, so I'll take a hint from them and follow suit. Installing the CPU cooler is easy. The cooling block and the pump just slip down over the screws in the backing plate. And then you just tighten down the thumb screws. Next, we'll install the RAM. We'll be using DDR3, and with this CPU, it runs as dual channel, so it's important to make sure the memory in each channel is paired. I'll post a separate video that provides more detail about single, dual, and quad channel, so we can keep this one moving along. The wiring for the CPU cooler is straightforward. Plug the pump into the CPU fan header. You plug the fan on the radiator into the other wire coming from the pump. And you plug the USB connector from the pump into an available USB 2.0 header. I'm just going to tie the cooling tubes off to the cable for the 24-pin power for now. If you take a look at the back of the case, you'll see that the S340 has a different approach for cable management. It's simple, it's clean, and I like it. Most of the cabling fits neatly behind the blue wiring panel. We can just tie it together. The wiring for the front panel header can slide under here. And the HD audio from the front panel goes here. And then you slide the power for the CPU here. Let's wire this up. Ah, unlike the Intel motherboard, the ASRock does post. The S340 has an intake filter, and there are openings at the top and the bottom of the S340 front cover to ensure that plenty of air gets into the case. Now, the T-junction max for this CPU is 100 Celsius, but I'm honestly not comfortable running it above 80. The same i7 used to idle at 55 and hit well over 70, even under a small load in the old HP. Notice the idle temperature with this setup. We'll use the heavy load app to bring the CPU usage up to 100% on all cores. That'll stress it a bit so we can see how the cooler works. Notice that the temperature quickly moves up to mid-50s and then it stabilizes. It used to run hotter than that and idle on the old case. It doesn't look like heavy load can even challenge the NVIDIA GPU. Now, if we run tests on both, it shows that the CPU temperature is stable under load and remains in the mid-50s. I'll break down the individual bits of this build as separate videos in the series. That Intel motherboard failure put me way behind schedule, so I need to get this rig back to work. Watch how quickly the temperature recovers as soon as I remove the load. Excellent.